Shireen, how are you?
Hi, it's great to see you, Rudy, again. Thank you for sharing with us during your weekend. That's
Yes, I'm happy to be here to share the story about process mining.
yes. Last presentation comes from Rudy, and it's very important because the presentation of Dr. Fatma was about AI and how we think and about the knowledge itself. Then we moved to a great experience and a great journey by Anthony, who gave us lots of stories and insights and change management and how people, how process, how technology. And after that came Frederick and gave us fantastic, amazing tools that can make everything easy. But there is always a missing part, invisible part in our processes. We invest in technology, we bring best solutions, ERPs, and we do thousands of transactions inside the company every hour, every day, sometimes every minute, and no one has the time to analyze it all. So here comes the fantastic concept of process mining. So in not only data mining, process mining as well. For me, I'm impressed about it. We are happy to introduce to you our partner, Flexicom. So they have an amazing software called Disco or Discovery. It's not for dancing, it's for discovery.
Also for dancing a
So,
bit, right?
Rudy, please.
Yeah, thanks. And thanks for the introduction. Let me share my screen first, so then we slide directly into it. So I'm not, am I able to share? Oh,
You are allowed to.
yeah. Okay. Yeah, you can see the presentation now, right?
Fantastic.
Okay,
Yes.
excellent. Yeah, so welcome all. I'm Rudy. I'm from Flexicom. We develop process mining software. We are doing this for quite some time. It all started almost 15 years ago at the Technical University here in Eindhoven in the Netherlands. We were PhD students back then. And there was a group headed by Professor Will van der Aalst, who is the founding father of process mining. And we were thinking about how we can improve the way to analyze processes. And so we were used to look at these processes to do value stream mapping or the business process mapping or modeling. But we saw that more and more processes become automated. And then, of course, you can use new techniques in order to analyze these processes. So it all started with developing the new technology. So the technology in order to discover processes from data. And of course, in the coming 30 minutes, I will give you an overview. So Professor Will van der Aalst also wrote a book about it, process mining. So if you are interested and if you want to learn more about the academic background and all the applications there, this is a great resource to get started. And at the Technical University, they also developed a MOOC, a massive online course called Process Mining, Data Science in Action. And this course also teaches everything you need to know about process mining. It's quite academic, and so if you want to apply it in practice, then there is some mathematics to it. But if you're interested in that, then this would be a great resource as well. Yeah, so we at Fluxicon are more practical oriented. So we develop the process mining software, but we see that you actually need two things. Of course, the software is great, but of course you need to develop these skills in order to apply it in practice. Looking at process from a data perspective is completely different. And so you really start looking at where is the data in our systems, and then extract this data in order to create these process visualizations, but also to understand where you are looking for. So we have written an online book. You can find it on www.processminingbook.com. It includes all resources, it's freely available, so you can just check it out. So process mining, what is it? So in order to explain what it is, I want to take you back 150 years ago in the 19th centuries, where the sailors were sailing the seas. And there was a captain Matthew Fontaine Maury, and he was a captain for U.S. Navy. And in 1842, he started working for the U.S. Navy Observatory. And he started studying logbooks. So the logbooks, which were produced from all the journeys done by the different sailors across the U.S. Nobody thought that these logbooks were actually valuable, but he started studying them. It looks something like this. So it includes some information about the journey and the different type of color currents. He started to analyze them. So each journey which was taken, at which moment it was taken, and where the currents were, what the wind directions were, and all this information he used in order to develop these books indicating the currents and the wind directions. And these handbooks, of course, can be used by sailors in order to determine what's the best moment in order to go at sea, to take the journey. And Captain Jackson was one of the first who used these logbooks in order to travel from Baltimore to the Rio de Janeiro. And he was able to make that journey 1 month quicker than normal. So you can imagine that if you can speed up these journeys, that you can do more journey and save a lot of costs. And from the introduction of these handbooks, in the first 7 years, they were able to save 2.5 million in the US only and 10 million globally. So this only for the first year. So you can imagine that how much savings they actually made on introducing these logbooks, these logbooks, if you look at the current one. So what has this to do with process mining? So with process mining, we kind of do the same thing. So with process mining, we extract data from the production systems in our operations, create log data, and then apply process mining in order to create these real life process models and to get insights in how the actual process works. So we are not using these logbooks, which these sailors produced, but the transactional data from our systems. And what kind of data you actually need, I will come to that in a moment. And we are not generating these maps in order to travel the seas, but these process maps in order to understand how our processes actually work. And then of course, the question is why do we need that? And that's kind of the old process problem. And so if we start discussing processes in our practice, then often people envision these processes as kind of a linear sequence of activities. And of course, these actual processes are not executed in this linear order. There's often a lot of variation. And so on the left side, we see these processes, how we think the process is actually working. But on the right side, this is the actual process where we see some deviations which can happen in this process. But the problem here is that we actually don't have an idea of how the actual process is being executed. And this, of course, has a couple of causes. So processes tend to be subjective. So everyone has his own view of how these processes are actually working, and which terms and analogies are being used for these processes. And processes are often an interchange between different departments or different individuals working together. And everyone sees their own part of their processes. And processes tend to grow over time. When new regulations are introduced or new products are introduced, new exceptions are also introduced into these processes. And finally, when we start digitizing these processes, they become more and more hidden into our systems. So it's not always clear how the process actually works. We need to understand from the system how these processes run. So what we do with process mining is we extract data from the production system and then generate these process maps. And this process maps gives you an idea of the actual process. So how the process run through the system. and then use that information in order to find discrepancies between how we think the process works versus how the actual process works. Yeah, and one of the big advantages of process mining is that we don't need a very complex data structure. So we actually just need three ingredients in order to make it work. And so the first ingredient we need is what we call a case ID. And so some object we want to track across the process. And this, it could be, for example, a patient that is actually streaming to a hospital, but it could also be a purchasing order or a purchasing order number, which we want to track across the purchasing process. The second thing we need is the activity or the step that's actually happening in the process or a status change. And the third thing is what we call the timestamp. So the moment at which this activity or status change is happening. And using these three ingredients, we can create these process maps. How does it work? So I don't want to go in all the details how these algorithms work. So the MOOC, for example, covers that topic, but I just want to give you an overview of the concept. So on the left side here, we see a very simplified event log with three customers and then activities running from A to E. And if I look at the first customer, then it has a sequence of activities that's being performed. And so the first customer has this linear order of activities running A all the way to E. But if I look at the second customer, it has a variation for this particular process. And so this process doesn't go from A to B, but from A to C, and then proceeds to B, and then continues to D and E. And so it created a new variant of the process. And then if we look at the third case or the third customer, and then it has also a new variant. So in this particular case, for example, if they send out the invoice at activity D and something went wrong finally they need to correct this invoice. So the invoice is sent out again. And then in this particular situation, step D is performed twice. So you can see here that from the data, we have discovered three customers for which they have three different type of sequences or three variants of this process. And what the process mining algorithm does is creates a process map that actually fits these different variants. So if we look just at the first customer, then we have this linear sequence. But if we need to create a process that also includes the second variant for the second customer, and then we get a process that we can go from A to B and then continue to C, or from A to C and then continue to B. And if we even include the third case, and then we have this repetition of activity D here, and then we create a self loop of activity D happening multiple times. And so the process mining software or algorithm does this for you. And now how this works, I will demonstrate in a moment. So I have a data set here. So it's a data set from a purchasing process. And typically what you would do is extract the data from the production system. So it could be an ERP system, a CRM system, or any other type of system, but you actually need these three ingredients. So in this particular case, the data is coming from an ERP system. And here we are following a purchase requisition to the purchasing process.
Someone is asking you to share the screen. I see it very well, but maybe she cannot see or something.
Am I not sharing the screen?
Yes, I can see it actually, but can you share again?
Yeah.
Sometimes technology. Can you just stop share and share again, please?
Yeah, I will.
Now she can see it now.
Okay.
Well, he can see it now. He says yes, he can see it now.
Okay great. Perfect. So here we can see that we have a case ID here on the left side. So that's the purchasing requisition going through the process. We have the activity. So that's actually the step happening in the purchasing process. And we have a starting timestamp. And that starting timestamp here represents the starting timestamp of this activity create purchase requisition. And we also have a completion timestamp. So the moment at which this create purchase requisition actually is completed. And using these three ingredients, we can already apply process mining. But you can also add additional information. So in this particular case, we added the resource. So in this example, Nico here was the person who created this purchase requisition, and also including the role of Nico, which is the requester. And using this, what's very typical of this process mining data is, if I highlight it here, is the case ID is not unique, but it's repetitive. So using this case ID, we track all the activities of this particular case to the process. And if we have this data in this particular format, then we can use a process mining software, DISCO, in this particular example. And DISCO stands for discovery. And I can open this file. And so you can have this in an Excel format or a CSV format. And then if I import this in the process mining software here, you would see actually the same thing as you would see, be able to see in Excel. And the first thing what I need to do here is, of course, let the software know what each column means. And so the first column here is a case ID, and on top I have a number of labels where I can assign the meaning of each of these columns. And so the first column is the case ID, which I will label as a case ID. The second column here is the timestamp, which will be assigned as a timestamp. The completion timestamp is a timestamp as well. Then we have this activity, which is represented by the envelope here. Then we can add a resource and a role. And the role here is represented as an other activity. And when I completed the configuration here, I can start import, and then the process mining algorithm goes to work. And the process mining algorithm automatically generates this process map for you. And so nothing else is added, only the data is being used in order to create this process visualization. And so this visualization is automatically generated here based upon the data. And so like every process, if I zoom in, it has a starting point. So here at the top, and so it's composed of 608 cases. And if I scroll down, and it has an endpoint here, so ending the process. And what you can see here, each of these activities are being generated from the data. These dark blue activities are the activities which happen most often. And so this step, analyze request for quotation, happened 1,107 times. And the light gray activities are more exceptional behavior in this particular process. So the amend purchase requisition step only happened 11 times in this particular process. And also the paths between the activities indicate dominant behavior. So the thick paths happen most often, and the light gray paths are more exceptional behavior in this particular process. And so using process mining, we can now already try to understand how this purchasing process actually works. And so starting from the top, the 608 cases passing through this process, they all start with create purchase requisition. Then most cases here go travel to analyze purchase requisition. Then the next step is create request for quotation request manager. And then the third step here is analyze request for quotation. And then we see this dominant loop going through this amend step.
Well, Rudy, if I may ask, because we always do this part of process excellence, and everyone we have tried it, it was like, aha, people like, wow, is this really what is going on? So it's based on the real time stamps. So it's reality. No one can deny it. It's a shock, yes, but it's reality. It's not a post-it notes which we will have, or stopwatch, follow-up process, or no, it's reality.
Yeah. So it's data coming from the production system. So it describes how these cases, in this particular example, a purchasing order passes through the purchasing process here. Yeah. So it describes the process reality from a data perspective, and that can be used in order to do the analysis. But of course, what we see in practice, and that's what we will see in this example analysis as well, is that it can help you to identify these bottlenecks and problems in this process very quickly. But like any other data analysis technique, you need to engage with domain experts in order to understand what is actually happening. So data is always telling part of the story. Yeah? It cannot tell everything, and because that assumes that you would collect all the data there is, and that's at the moment not the case for most companies.
Yeah. Yes, but we always consume. We have been consuming lots of time and wasting lots of time in measuring and getting the data. But this way, we only get it like 2-3 days maximum.
Yeah.
Which is amazing, and it makes the automation for analysis. So it's interesting, because some people always say, "Is this real?" Yes, it's real.
Yeah, it's real. Yeah, and it's being applied. So I will, at the end of the presentation, I will give you some examples where you can see how various customers have been using it in practice. And we have a process mining camp, and they have presented their particular use cases. So they explain how they're actually using it. So it has a very broad field of application.
So it's basically a replay. As we say, replay of reality.
Yeah, I will come to that in a moment, so you can actually bring the process to life.
Yes. Okay, please go on. Continue.
We represent this process and then discover the process to understand how it works. But often these processes are quite complex. So in this particular example, this process is simplified to explain how it works. But often we see that the result of these processes become very, very complex and result into a spaghetti-like visualization. So often what you can do as a next step in order to discover the process is to explore. And the exploration is a very big part of the discovery of these processes. And in order to support the exploration, we have two sliders here on the right side. So the activity slider and the path slider. And using these two sliders, we can simplify these process maps. And so when I start pulling down this activity slider, you will see that the process map itself will become simpler and simpler. And so some of the activities which are less frequent or less dominant are being removed from the process map. And so now when I pull down the activity slider all the way to 0%, I get a linear process. And this linear process is actually describing the process that happens most often, hopefully the happy flow of this particular process. And so we describe now a very simple linear process. And if I engage with a domain expert and would be able to show this particular process, they should be able to recognize it because this is the process that happens most often. And when I pull up the activity slider again, then you can see that more detail is being added to the process map. And so one of the activities which was hidden before is, for example, this amend purchase requisition step. It only happened 11 times for the 608 case, so it's very exceptional in this particular process. And it was hidden, affected by the activity slider. But there's still something weird going on. So if I look at this activity, then 11 cases are coming from this analyze purchase requisition step. And if I look at the outgoing error, only 8 cases are coming out. And so we are missing 3 cases. And this is because we are still looking at a simplified version of this process. So we don't see all the paths yet. And this is because the path slider here is set to a 0%. But if I start pulling up this path slider, you will see that there is actually more detail in this particular process. And so when I look at this amend purchase requisition step again, then I can actually see that there is a path going from amend purchase requisition going to create request for quotation requester, which happened 3 times. And using the path slider, this is a low frequent path, it was hidden before. So when I pull up both the activities and path slider, I can see the full complexity of this process map. So using process mining, we start with analyzing these maps, but of course we get statistics as well. And so in the middle here, we have a statistics steps, and one of the statistics here is case duration. And then we can see the distribution of this case duration here. And if you imagine that you are the manager of this purchasing process, and then it could be that there is an SLA of this process that it should be completed within 21 days. So here I can already see that if I hover over it, that most of these cases here actually are completed within 19, 20 days. But there is a long tail. So some of these cases actually take much longer. And so it could already be interesting as a question. So now, how many of these cases are actually taking longer than 21 days? So from the statistics, we can even dive deeper into the process and move to the individual cases. So here we can see each of the purchasing requisitions. So there are 608 purchasing requisitions. And each of these purchasing requisitions are ordered according to what we call variants. So of the 608 cases, there are 98 different ways in order to execute this process. And these variants are ordered according to the frequency. So which variant happens most often. And so the first variant here, if I click on it, then I can see that there are actually 88 cases that are following this sequence in these 18 steps, from create purchase requisition in this particular order of 18 steps to pay invoice. And there are actually 88 examples in the data that is following this particular pattern. And the second variant also runs from create purchase requisition all the way to pay invoice, but actually just takes 17 steps. So there is a difference in the beginning of this process. And we can also see that in the map. So you can either take this direction, going to analyze purchase requisition for analyze request for quotation, or you can take this direction. Take just one step to end it, analyze request for quotation. And there is a third variant, which is very different. So it never reaches pay invoice. So it goes from create purchase requisition to analyze purchase requisition, and then nothing happens here. And we can also see that in the map. So it goes from create purchase requisition and then analyze purchase requisition. And then we see this dotted line going all the way to the end of this particular process. Does anyone have an idea of what's happening with this particular case? There are 63 examples that follow this particular pattern.
It is really amazing the insights and the data we can get from it, case by case, and any option we can have it. That's really amazing. It saves hundreds of hours of process analysis.
So in this particular example, so with the 63 cases, we are looking at a data analysis technique. So it doesn't have to be that all of these cases are completed yet. So one of the hypotheses here is we have these two steps, create purchase requisition, then the step analyze purchase requisition, and then nothing happens. And so it could be that this case is still work in progress. And if we pull a new data set a month from now, that these cases are actually reaching the end of this particular process. Another hypothesis here is that these cases are canceled. And so we have the step create purchase requisition, then analyze purchase requisition, but then these cases are actually canceled in the process. So nothing happens anymore. And we would be able to analyze each of these individual cases here to look at them, what happened with them. And we have this graph here at the top for each of these individual cases. And this graph is actually indicating the work in progress over time. And this red marking indicates where in the time frame. So this is the first timestamp in the data set. This is the last one. So the x-axis here represents time. And the red marking indicates where in the time frame this particular case 948 is actually happening in this time frame. So if I move to some of the examples, you can see that all of these cases are not a particular place in the time frame. So if we assume that these cases would be work in progress, then it's most likely that most of these cases would be started at the end of the time frame, but this is not happening. So and from the hypothesis perspective, it's more likely that these cases would be canceled then. So we can analyze it from the map, the statistics, and the individual cases. We can look at the frequency, so how often things are happening. But we can also change the perspective to the performance because we have the timestamp. And let me move to the mean duration here. And then we can change the metrics. And so now we can see time in each of the activities and each of the parts. And so here we can see that the create purchase requisition activity from the starting point till the end point of this activity took on average 30.7 minutes. And after completing this create purchase requisition activity, and before starting the create request for quotation request or step, it waits there for 4.1 hours. And so now we can see the active time and the passive time on the arcs. And also the coloring changes. So now the dark red activity, which is here, indicates the activity that actually takes most time in this particular process. So the delivering of the goods and services on average takes 25.3 hours, which is the activity that actually takes most time. And the red arrows here point towards the bottleneck in this particular process. And so here we see this analyze request for quotation step, which only takes 23 minutes to complete, but it waits there 10.5 days, 8.5 days, 4.3 days on average before it actually gets started. So using process mining, we can find these bottlenecks very quickly in the analysis, and then engage with the domain experts in order to find the actual root cause, of course, because in this particular scenario, it still could be various things. And so it could be that you don't have enough resources in order to fulfill the demand, but it could also be that they are waiting here for an approval of a manager, which is only available once a week, for example. So in order to engage with the domain experts, you can bring this process to life, creating an animation out of it. And then you can replay this process based upon the time frame. So you can see the time running here, and each yellow dot represents a purchasing order here flowing through the process at a given moment in time. And so we can see now, relative to time, how each of these purchase requisitions are actually passing through this particular process. And when you start engaging with these domain experts, this can be very helpful to create a visualization of their process and then start discussing what is actually happening. And so why are these cases here traveling so slowly through this particular path, going from amends request for quotation requester to analyze request for quotation? What is actually happening here? And why do we need this particular activity? And if we move further into the process, and look at a particular other moment in time, and why are these activities waiting for the delivery to start? So using these visualization, it helps to engage with the domain experts to start asking the right questions about the process, right, without having to map out the process first, which of course can take some time. So maybe let me stop here for a moment to see if there are any questions. So of course there are a couple of other things which I would like to show, but maybe it's a good moment to see if there are any questions here.
So basically you can get all the data you want, as you mentioned, and the different variants of the process, right? Mm-hmm. Because there's always a gap between what we think and what is actually happening, different versions. Okay.
Yes.
So, can people, for example, for internal control and audit, use process mining?
Yeah, of course.
Compliance?
Yeah. So there are various type of use cases for process mining. So of course you can use it for a process optimization to identify where there are bottlenecks in the process to eliminate them and improve the process. Another great use case for process mining is from an audit compliancy point of view. And so of course, if you look at the process from an audit perspective, then you would expect that the process takes a particular path. So then you are looking for deviations of that this process description. And so where do you see the deviations, or have particular things not happened? So did we take a particular part that should not actually happen, which I can show you in a moment. And another one is for I principles, segregation of duties. And so, for example, if an activity if you have two activities in the process and one should be performed by another person than the other activity, then of course, with process mining, you should also be able to check that if that happens for all the cases. And one of the advantages is from an auditing perspective. And so typically an auditor would take samples in order to do this check or do a process review, for example. But now, based upon the data, they would be able to check everything. And so for all the data in the system, they would be able to see if they breach particular rules.
That's amazing. I think it's really amazing because it's using the reality, what is going on, and it's, you don't have to invest in expensive simulation modeling. You can just have it, and it's easy. It's easy. Yeah. Okay, so can we go on, because we only have 9 minutes to go?
Yeah, sure.
please.
Yeah. So the discovery is the first part of process mining. So to understand how the process works, but of course the second part is try to answer questions about the process itself. So in order to support that, there are filters here. So we can answer questions, for example, so how many of these cases actually take longer than 21 days? So I'm not fulfilling the SLA. So now we can create a filter, in this case, a performance filter, and can look for all the cases that actually take longer than 21 days. So I just move the slider here. We can see here the distribution of the lead time. And if I look at all the cases that take longer than 21 days, then I can already see that 15% of these cases actually take longer than 21 days. So now I can look at these cases which take too long. And the result is actually, again, a process map, but let me show you the frequency perspective again. Now I don't get all the 608 cases, but only the 92 cases that actually take longer than 21 days. And also the pattern changes. And so now we can see that this analyze request for quotation activity is dark blue, and also the amend request for quotation requester activity is dark blue. And we see this thick loop indicating that probably there's a lot of rework between these two activities circling around. And we already see this, there are only 92 cases, but this step analyze request for quotation happens almost 400 times, and so factor four. And if I look at the performance view, and every time I travel to this amend step and travel back, it adds almost 15 days to the lead time. So of course, going through this amend step could be one of the causes why we have this delay in these cases that take too long. And we can also see in the cases step, and if we look at the first variant now, what actually happening. So now we see, we don't see a linear sequence going from create purchase requisition to pay invoice, but now we have this repetition going from analyze to amend to analyze to amend several times. So already in the variant, so in the case which happens most often in this particular process, we see this rework loop happening. So using process mining, we can identify where are these root causes in the process. And of course, again, engage with the domain experts to try to create new ideas in order to remove these bottlenecks in this process and make this process more efficient. So this is from a performance perspective, but if I change and go back to the original data set here, and then move to the frequency. So now we are looking at all cases again. If you look here at the process more from a compliancy point of view, and then we have a nice example here at the bottom where we send out the invoice. And so here the invoice is being sent out. So there are actually 413 invoices being sent out. And we have the step release supplier's invoice, which happened 403 times. But it's odd because every invoice should be released. And we see here that actually 10 cases skip or bypass this release supplier's invoice step. And this should not happen. So from a compliancy point of view, you want to look at all the cases that actually taking this path that should not happen. So what we can do now is just interact with this process map by clicking on this path and then filter this path. So now we are looking at all the cases that skip the release step. So now we get these 10 cases that actually skip this release supplier's invoice step. And you can argue whether or not the process map is very interesting right now, but these 10 cases are. And so from a compliancy point of view, you want to look at these 10 cases. What is happening with these 10 cases? And who was responsible for sending out the invoice? How did it come that they skipped the release supplier's invoice step? Was there a particular risk involved? Was there potential fraud involved for these cases where we see this particular pattern? And now we can review each of these 10 cases and to see what's happening. And if you include the resource, then of course you would also know who to contact to ask more information about these individual cases.
Okay.
So this is more from a compliancy point of view. If we go back again, then we have looked at this process from the individual step perspective. And you know, what's very typical of processes is that it has different granularity levels. So this is quite detailed level of this particular process. And so we see all the individual steps happening in this process. And but if I go back to my original data import, then I also have this concept of the role here, or the organizational unit. So this is the role of this particular resource, which is happening in the process. And I can take different perspectives on this process. So in this particular case, I just need to change the role and make the role here the activity. And then the activity here, some other attribute. So now I'm looking at the process from the role perspective. So when I start importing the data, I'm using actually the same data set, but just create a new visualization on a different perspective of this process. And so now I'm looking at this particular process from the handover perspectives between the different roles. And so the process here starts with the requester, and I can see all the handovers. And so from the requester, most cases go to the purchasing agent, some cases required to pass to the request manager. So you can take actually different perspectives using the same data set to answer different type of questions. And so if I'm now a question more related to cost savings for a particular department, and if I look at this purchasing process and I want to see where most time is actually being spent in this particular process, then I can see that the supplier here is actually spending most time. So in total for the whole data set, 14.5 months. And the purchasing agent is second, and so 35.8 weeks. And so from a cost saving perspective, if I want to look at activities and try to simplify or automate activities, then I need to take a look at these two departments or two roles. But also from the handover perspective, I can see here that most time is being spent between the request manager forwarding it to the purchasing agent. And so what's actually blocking here? And so why does it take so long? So you can actually take, using the same data set, multiple perspectives on your process and answer different type of questions using each of these perspectives. So let me go back and show you some use cases. So if we look at process mining, so what's very typical of process mining, and I think in the discussion of the previous talk, this was also covered a bit. So if we look at process mining, it requires an analysis. So it's a data analysis technique. And so we capture data from a particular system and we start discovering this process to understand how it works. But it really requires a human analyst in order to analyze these processes. You need to add domain knowledge in order to understand what's actually happening to be able to draw conclusions. And what you are doing here with process mining is bringing the data perspective and the process perspective together. And so it requires skills on both sides. So one of the advantages of process mining is that you can deal with this complexity. So all the deviations and complexity of these processes are actually captured using process mining. But you actually need to formulate really good questions in order to zoom in and to see what's actually happening in this process. So who is using then process mining? So of course it can be used inside or outside the company. And so we see that consultants are using this as a tool in order to support their customers, in order to support them to improve processes or understand how they work. But also external auditors, for example, to review processes. But also within a company. So for example, process managers can use it to improve their own processes. Data science teams can use it to discover processes or improve their prediction models. Process improvement teams, and when they are doing this lean or process excellence initiatives as a tool to discover the process and then try to identify bottlenecks and start monitoring the improvements. And finally, also the IT departments. So for example, looking at particular systems, how are they being used? And so you can also use process mining to analyze click streams. And now for these particular use cases, what we do every year is organize process mining camp So of course, due to COVID this year, it was not a physical conference, but an online conference. But typically we are doing this in Eindhoven at the university, at the birthplace of process mining. I got it together with the process mining community and then share best practices about process mining. So the practitioners themselves, they share their stories and we record them. And all these stories are available at processminingcamp.com. And so if you want to look at these particular use cases, you can watch the videos there. So for example, one video, if you are interested in process mining, how it's being applied for process excellence, Joris Keizer has used it in FACO. It's a production manufacturing company. They produce particular metals for the healthcare industry. And they have used process mining as a tool in the Lean Six Sigma toolbox in order to improve their processes to speed up the lead time from production to delivery. So you can find it on the CAMP website as well there. But also, for example, Freek from ASML, he have used process mining to analyze how the systems, they produce systems which produce chips, and the maintenance of these systems are of course very important, and they have a lot of maintenance procedures, and they capture the logs from these systems in order to see if the maintenance procedures are actually followed how they actually should, and they identified that they can make tremendous improvements in order to run these maintenance sequences more effectively. But also from a compliance point of view, so Mark Glitter and Patrick Grefsku presented in 2016 their use case at DHL, how they use process mining as part of their audit compliance practice. And finally, at this year's camp, Carmen Vermeer and Noortje Groenendaal from Total presented how they actually use process mining to discover the journey, the customer journey. And so if you have all these touch points from the different systems, you combine them together into one event log, and then of course you can track the customer through the whole journey of these systems, and then start analyzing if the actual design journey complies the journey how the customer is actually going through the process. So there are different type of applications. Every year we see still new ideas of how process mining is being applied. what we offer at Fluxicon is the process mining software. So if you are interested, then you can go to our website. You can download the software, try it out, and let us know, and we would be happy to give you a free trial for 30 days to get you started.
So thank you, Rudy, for all of this. It's really amazing. Okay, so one of the colleagues here wrote, it's amazing. So this is a very useful solution. Thank you for introducing it. One of the questions, could Desco integrate with Oracle for collecting data?
Yes, this is possible. So with Desco, we have a data source integration, which we call Airlift. And then you can also directly connect to a data source and then pull the data directly from a data source into Desco for your analysis. For Oracle, of course, so all these different type of systems require that the data is being extracted and then be relayed into Desco. Oracle, OBS has been a source, but also the Siebel CRM system, for example, has been a great source for process mining as well.
So it's basically as we did with one of our customers together. We get the data from IT team and we just map it and we play it. It's so easy.
Yeah.
We usually get it in form of XES files, right?
You can use XES files, but you can also extract plain CSV files, for example, or use the Airlift integration and then pull it directly into Desco.
Okay.
And that works based upon REST API.
Yes, it can be done with Oracle, with SAP, with any CRM system, with any database. You have the data there.
You just need to have these three ingredients. Eh? So if you have a case study, timestamp, and activity, then you can use it. Yeah.
Yes, yes. Yeah. Just unique case ID. Could be anything. Case ID could be an order number, anything. Just a case ID. Could be a patient in a hospital, medical record. Could be anything. Just a unique case ID. And we map Justin's, and it makes our life easy. So there's a question, what criteria the database architects should plan and consider to make use of DESCO easy and quickly? And how much does it cost?
Yeah. So if you look at it from a data perspective, the process mining software DESCO, we focus on the process mining analysis part, of course. And we see that most companies already have a data infrastructure. And so they already have either a local data infrastructure for a particular system or a data infrastructure for organizing centrally. And so more or less a BI infrastructure or data science infrastructure. And what they are using for this infrastructure could be anything. And so it could be an ETL type of tool. It could be Power BI setup. It could be a Python setup to extract and transform data. So extracting and transforming data is not specifically needed for process mining. So it's kind of a more generic technique. So if you look at process mining, what's really needed is that you start pulling this transactional data into this central source in order to be able to collect it and also maintain it. And also start working on improving the data quality of this particular type of data.
But I think there is a point of awareness here we have to be careful of, Rudy, because sometimes some companies don't save the data of the transactions. They simply, for Oracle, for example, there is an option to keep the data for audit. And sometimes we faced it with IT people who don't save the data. It comes all of it, or the transaction having the same date.
Yeah, we have a nice example of an insurance company in the Netherlands. And so they actually had a system and then they mentioned, we don't have these transactional logs. And then the auditor started looking into it. There was just one checkbox that needed to be enabled in order to produce this type of data, but they were just not collecting it because there was no purpose in order to do it. And so there's also often a chicken and egg problem. So if you don't have this purpose in order to analyze these processes, then of course you don't start collecting this data. And so it goes hand in hand. And so often what we see in practice with most of the people starting with process mining is doing this for the first time, create an iteration, extract simply a simple data set first, run it through DESCO to do a first analysis, see what you can get out of it, build some experience with it, engage with the domain experts to hear what they think, and then create value. And then go back, what was the data which I used? And how can I organize it in a way that I start maintaining this data? And so start managing the transactional data as part of the data infrastructure as well. And for the cost in order to deploy this, it depends. So if this infrastructure is already available, then of course you're just adding this transactional data to that infrastructure and allocate resources in order to maintain this data as well.
Yes, so it's always it's interesting. We'll find lots of aha and shocks. So how does it cost? It's a monthly subscription, right?
So DESCO is it can be used in different license models. So it can be used just on a month-to-month base or in an annual model, so a year model. We also offer permanent licenses. The pricing is not public, but if you are interested, then you can just reach out, and then we find it interesting to hear about the use case to see the offer which we can make.
So can you just type your email in the chat, please, so people can reach you directly, and the link of the Process Mining Camp as well, because the pricing of DESCO is very competitive. It's 1/10 of the other big players in the market. And it gives a fantastic value. So, I think that's it. We have great presentation from you, Rudy, and from everyone. So we will share, we will have the video uploaded, and we will share it with everyone, all the videos and all presentations. And thank you everyone for making the time, spending the day with us, spending your afternoon. and it has been really great. Thank you, Rudy. Thank you.
Okay, bye.
Okay, thank you everyone who has been with us all the day and visited with us this, your time. It's really great. Thank you everyone. Shukran ya jamaa wa assalamu alaikum. Shukran ala waqtukum. Thank you. We are available to reach us, okay, if you need anything. Thank you. Okay. If anyone has any question, we are available for anyone who wants to ask any question at any time. We'll be happy to answer you. Okay. Please make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel so you can have it. Okay. Yes, all the materials will be sent via email. المادة العلمية هنرسلها طبعا. Yes, we have LinkedIn. We will type for you here our LinkedIn page. No issue. Okay. I'll share with you LinkedIn. Okay. شكرا يا جماعه بنشكركم على وقتكم اني انفورميشن هنبعت لحضراتكم اللينك بتاعت لينكد ان بتاعت احنا تشرفنا بيكم تشرفنا بكل الناس اللي معانا النهارده